So good morning to all of you. So here we are in the final session of the current ISET webinar series. So we had 10 full sessions with the average participation of around 450 to 500 participants for each webinar. And we have received an overwhelming response. And I place my sincere thanks on behalf of ISET to all the participants for your excellent support towards the ISET webinar series. And today we have Professor Ashok Kumar, a retired professor from IIT Roorkee, to deliver a talk on earthquake early warning system and its relevance for India. So before going to the webinar, I welcome Professor T.G. Sitaram, the President, Indian Society of Earthquake Technology and Director, IIT Roorkee, to welcome the participants and the opening remarks. Professor Sitaram, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please.
Very, very good morning to all of you. So it gives me a great pleasure to welcome all of you to this very important ISET webinar series, and in particular, my friend Professor Ashok Kumar, who is actually delivering on a very interesting topic: earthquake early warning system. See, whenever there is an earthquake, everybody is asking, when are you going to predict our earthquakes? Okay, so he will tell you the problems and the challenges, and also he is going to highlight some of the important contribution what as a scientist in India, and particularly his group at IIT Roorkee, has made towards the early warning system, and how this entire thing works, and what how it is useful for the community, particularly the earthquake engineering community. So these few remarks, I would like to again remind all of you, please look at the 7th International Conference on Earthquake Geotechnical Engineering, ICRAGI website, ICRAGI, 7th ICRAGI, which is going to be held in July 2021 in Indian Institute of Science at Jain Tata Auditorium, Bangalore. In July 2021, please, you know, go to the website and look at it and register for the conference. Another one, we are also very happy to tell you that we are making a big progress in bidding for the World Conference on Earthquake Engineering in 2024. Hopefully, we will give you a good news by the end of November. By the end of November, the decision should be made. But please remember, this international conference, this World Conference on Earthquake Engineering, will be only held in 2024 if we are selected by the international body IAEE. So with these few announcements, I warmly welcome Professor Ashok Kumar to give his talk on earthquake early warning system, its relevance for India. And I again warm welcome to all of you, because I see more than 330 people who have joined today for this webinar. So that shows how much our ISET webinar series is popular. So I would like to again take the opportunity to thank all our secretary, Professor Ravi Jakka, Rivalsa Polatayar, who is the coordinator of this, and many other members like Professor Dinesh, Professor Vasant Matsagar, and then Gupta and Churasia, and many others who really worked to make this seminars very popular. Thank you very much. So it's over to Professor Ashok Kumar. Maybe I think
I will introduce. Thank you, Professor Sitaram.
You can introduce the speaker.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Srivalsa. It is my pleasure to introduce today's esteemed speaker, Professor Ashok Kumar, who is a retired professor from Department of Earthquake Engineering at IIT Roorkee. So he will be delivering this 10th ISET webinar on the earthquake early warning system, its relevance for India. So Professor Ashok Kumar has completed his bachelor's degree in civil engineering with honors from BITS Pilani in 1972. Then he completed Master of Engineering in 1974, and subsequently he completed his doctoral degree from IIT Roorkee. He had joined the Faculty of Earthquake Engineering Department at IIT Roorkee in year 1976. He was quite instrumental in the development of the first computer control shake table in India and the modern strong ground motion instrumentation network, as well as strong motion data website, which is www.psmos.in. For the last several years, he has been working on earthquake early warning system and was then a team leader which developed the first earthquake early warning system of our country, which is presently in operation in Uttarakhand state. He has guided as many as 12 PhDs and 39 MTech students, and he has published more than 120 publications in various journals and conferences. So we are glad, Professor Ashok Kumar, that you are delivering today's ISET webinar. So over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Vasant. I hope you are able to listen to my voice.
Yes, Professor Ashok Kumar, we are able to hear you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Vasant, for your kind introduction. Good morning to all the participants. First of all, I'd like to thank Professor Sitaram, President, Indian Society of Earthquake Technology, for giving me this platform to be in front of this great audience. I must also compliment the wonderful webinar team of ISET for very efficiently conducting this series of webinars and giving it a good publicity. Friends, this is a rare chance for me in which I am speaking to several hundred people. What better opportunity than this to express my gratitude to my alma maters, BITS Pilani, where I did graduation, and IIT Roorkee, where I got subsequent degrees. IIT Roorkee subsequently became my karam bhumi, where I learned A to W of earthquake engineering, not to A to Z, because still X, Y, Z I haven't learned. After 45 years of golden period at IIT Roorkee, presently I live in Noida, but I know my heart and soul will always remain in the campus of IIT Roorkee. I owe to IIT Roorkee every bit of the presentation which I will be making here today. Finally, I dedicate this presentation in remembrance of my gurus who are no more in this world, but have made immense contribution in the field of earthquake engineering. And the first and the foremost name comes Professor Jay Krishna, a legend figure of earthquake engineering, who started earthquake engineering in India and who was the founder of the Department of Earthquake Engineering in IIT Roorkee. The next name is Professor Arya, again, with whom I was also had the opportunity to work with. And I hope you must all be knowing the name of Professor Arya, who has top personality in structural dynamics in the country, who was a top personality. Another name is Professor Chandrasekaran, Professor B.C. Mathur, and Professor L.S. Srivastav. All these people are no more in this world, but they have the contribution of theirs was the starting of earthquake engineering in our country. At this instant of time, my only living guru is Professor Basu, who lives in Calcutta, for whom I wish a very long life. I sincerely hope that I'll receive blessings of my gurus for this presentation. With this brief introduction, I'd like to start my presentation. Well, this is a beautiful grand building of IIT Roorkee. It's not only the grand building, but what's done inside is much, much bigger. And I'm proud that IIT Roorkee is the institute which has made immense contribution in the development of our country in the nation building. So my topic of my presentation is earthquake early warning system, its relevance for India. First of all, I tell you that earthquake early warning system, I'm not talking about the prediction of earthquake. We know that earthquakes cannot be predicted. So it's not the prediction that I'm doing. So what is an earthquake early warning system? I'll start with my next slide. Well, this is an earthquake record which typically we must have seen, most of you must have seen. Here you see that there is no earthquake here. The zero straight line is coming. and from somewhere here the earthquake starts. And we also know that the first P wave arrives. P wave arrives because the velocity of P wave is approximately 6 kilometers per second. And subsequently, S waves arise because their velocity is smaller than the P wave velocity. So S waves arise a little later. Now, so we have a S minus P time available. We also know that during the P wave, the intensity of the shaking is substantially less. The intensity of the shaking increases when the S waves arrive. The question is, can within first few seconds of the arrival of P wave, can we estimate what will be the damage potentials of the S wave? How big will be the earthquake of the S wave? And this is the research topic, a very hot research topic in which we call it a real-time seismology. A very large amount of work is done on understanding the first few seconds of the P wave, understanding first few seconds of the P wave, and trying to find out, can we estimate the size of an earthquake by first few seconds of the P wave? Then we have some times of S minus P is available. But so S waves cause damage and destruction. S wave cause death and injury. P wave doesn't cause the death and injury. And S minus P time is available for warning. But this time is too small. It may be only few seconds, which may not be good enough for people to save their life. But last decade or so, we have a modern communication network. So an earthquake early warning system takes advantage of both the things, the S minus P time, as well as the speed of the modern communication network. I'll explain this in more detail in the next slide. Well, here is a slide where earthquake epicenter is here. Important thing of an early warning system is I must have sensors close to earthquake epicenter. That is the first requirement of an earthquake early warning system. Therefore, I must know where expected earthquakes are and fill that place with a lot of accelerometers or sensors. So in this case, you have an epicenter here. Close by, there is a seismometer, there is a sensor. Sensor is required to send the data 24/7 real time to a processing station, which may be somewhere here. This time of the sending of the data from here to here is almost zero. So earthquake has occurred. Sensor has sent the data here. Here the processing is done. And in first few seconds of the P wave, we estimate the size of an earthquake. And if we estimate the size of an earthquake to be big, we immediately send a warning to the target city. By that time, the S waves may not have traveled from here to here only. So this city has a lead time available. It's got the warning when the S waves are here. And from here to here, it has got the lead time where they can do a warning is given to them. So this is, but one thing is that we don't issue warning based on the one sensor only. We issue warning based on several sensors, and all those sensors have to be close to the epicenter of the earthquake. So we generally do it with 4 to 5 sensors. So if 4 to 5 sensors are simultaneously sending the data, we'll process that data from 4 or 5 sensors. And if we find the size of an earthquake to be big, we issue the warning to the cities, target cities. This is further demonstrated by another slide. In this slide, I'm saying that this is an earthquake epicenter. So earthquake strikes at this instant. First sensor picks up the data, sends it to this second sensor, picks up the data, third sensor picks up the data, fourth sensor picks up the data. It processes for few seconds and then issues warning, and the warning goes right up to this place. In this case, an earthquake has come to Chamoli and the warning is issued right up to the Chamoli. This has been done in absolute real time. If I redo this slide again, you will see that it took 13 seconds from the starting of an earthquake to issuing of the warning, it took 13 seconds. And in 13 seconds, the S waves have already traveled about 40 kilometers. So 40 kilometers is my blind zone where I am not be able to issue any warning. Beyond 40 kilometers, we have the warning time available. Now I'll discuss the various segments of earthquake early warning system. First and the most important and requires the maximum funding is the dense network of sensors. So an earthquake early warning system needs a substantially dense network of sensors where we expect a big earthquake to strike. In our country, it's Himalayas. We all know that Himalayas, big earthquake may strike any day. So the important requirement is that Himalayas must be densely instrumented with the sensor. The second is all the sensors in real time and 24/7 stream the data to central monitoring station. So 24/7, the data must be sent to the central monitoring station. And at central monitoring station, all the processing is required to be done. It should be capable to acquire the data. It should be able to detect the event. See, most of the time there is no earthquake. Suddenly an earthquake comes, so my algorithm must be able to detect an event has come. Then the next important thing is hypocentral location. Why hypocentral is required to be located, I'll discuss in my subsequent presentation. Then the next important thing is the magnitude estimation. That's the most important thing, because from the magnitude estimation, we take a decision whether to issue the warning or not to issue the warning. Generally, the warning is issued in case the magnitude exceeds 6. And the estimated magnitude exceeds 6. How the decision making is done, we'll discuss. We'll discuss some more important products which this type of a early warning system can make. A real-time mapping of PNS waves and ISO-PG intensity map of the region after the end of the event. So these are all very important products of the early warning system. And the next is obviously when the decision is made, the warning is required to be disseminated through sirens, through mobile apps, and through TVs and radios. We will discuss each and every aspect of this in our presentation. Now, first I'll discuss about the network of sensors. The question is, what type of a sensor? Should it be an acceleration sensor or should it be a velocity sensor? These are the two types of sensors which are generally used in seismology and earthquake engineering. Well, we know that velocity sensors have a very, very low natural frequencies. They are required to measure, very useful for measuring very small level of shaking, the micro earthquakes or the small level of the earthquakes or the weak motion recording. The velocity sensors are good for weak motion recording. And if subjected to, because the natural frequencies are very small, the pendulums are very, very soft. So even a small shaking, the pendulums respond. However, if velocity sensors are subjected to strong shaking, they go out of scale and may even get damaged. Wherever acceleration sensors have high natural frequencies, very stiff pendulum, basically designed for recording strong shaking. And in our case, we are right sitting in the NAPI central area. We are talking about magnitude 6-7 earthquake. So obviously we are talking about a strong shaking. So it has to be an acceleration sensor which we need to install for earthquake early warning system. Now, when we are talking about acceleration sensors, two types of sensors are available in the market. One is MEMS and another are force balance accelerometers. MEMS accelerometers are low cost. Whatever accelerometers that you are seeing in your mobile phones or in a laptop PC, or a lot of them inside the mobile automobiles, they're all small MEMS sensor, low cost. They can cost as small as $10. But the one that we use, it costs around $200-$300. The MEMS low-cost sensors. The problem with the MEMS sensors is that the dynamic range of the sensors is too small. Dynamic range means what is the minimum level of acceleration that it can measure. We said that maximum level is 2G, but the minimum level is decided by the noise content of the sensor. So if the noise content of the sensor is more, the dynamic range will be smaller. The ratio of the highest value that it can record and the lowest value it can record is called the dynamic range. And the dynamic range of the MEMS sensor is pretty bad because basically MEMS sensor has not been designed for seismological studies. Basically, they have been designed for other applications, and the cost of the dye, etc., really decides the cost of the sensor. And perhaps economically, it is not feasible for the manufacturers of the MEMS sensor to make MEMS for a higher dynamic range. So as of now, the best MEMS sensors that you can get is about 80 dB dynamic range, which is not good enough for future advancements of earthquake engineering. For present, what I have written is that present day MEMS are just enough for earthquake early warning system. The one sensor that we are using in IIT Roorkee are MEMS sensor, but they are just enough for, it can find only one parameter. For other parameters, it lacks the accuracy. And also, when we have the sensors, we have the strong ground motion data also. So this data is not only used for earthquake early warning, this can be used for several other studies on seismology and earthquake engineering. So when we are installing a sensor, early warning is surely the most important, but its data is required to be used for other applications, and that should also be kept in mind. And therefore, MEMS sensors presently available with a dynamic range of about 80 dB is just not enough. In future, MEMS may come up with a higher dynamic range, maybe 100. Our requirement is at least 120 to 130 dynamic range we must use, which will be good for all applications. So as of now, it is the force balance accelerometers which have the dynamic ranges between more than 120, 130 dB. They are the ones which are more suitable for earthquake early warning system than MEMS, for the simple reason that the MEMS has low dynamic range. Tomorrow, if technology comes up where the MEMS may come up with a dynamic range of the order of 120 dB, I'm sure it can come up, but people should be able to do it. But if tomorrow the market comes for the MEMS and they are cheaper than the, most important, they have to be cheaper than the SBA, then MEMS will be the one which should be used. So as of today, it's the force balance accelerometer which we must use. Next thing is the density of network. The density of the network is, we need to have a large density, as I was talking to you, large number of sensors around the epicentral area. Most of the places in the world, they have about 15 to 20 kilometers as the average sensor to sensor distance for their early warning system. But in our country, we are going to install sensors in an extremely difficult terrain of Himalayas, where the chances of communication failure is substantially high. Therefore, and we have our experience also with the present early warning system which we are operating at IIT Roorkee, that almost 40% of the sensors communications will be not available at any instant of time. So we need to have substantial amount of redundancy for an early warning system in Himalayas. And that is why for us, the average sensor to sensor distance is 8 to 10 kilometers, which we must have. So that takes care of the redundancy, and we have at least 15 kilometer sensors available in spite of failure of the communication. Now the question comes, where to install the sensors? The requirements are ground floor room, it has to be a ground floor room. The room has to be monolith with the ground. There are a lot of temporary structures where the ground floor is sitting on a small spacer between the ground and the ground floor. This type of a floor will not be suitable for us. Safety against vagaries of weather and the first three is a logistic requirement, but the most important technical requirement is reliable power availability and ready access to established communication network. So wherever we put our sensor, other than the first three, we need to have a very reliable power supply and a ready access to established communication. We need to have networking, maybe a BSNL or NIC or something. So what is the solution? In the Indian situation, every country has their own communication arrangements. Because they have their own, USA has their own communication system, Taiwan has their own communication system, Japanese have their own communication system. For us, the best is use National Informatics Center offices at district headquarters and SWAN offices at THQs and blocks. I do not know, but most of you should know that National Informatics Center is the Government of India's ministry center, which has networked all the districts of the country. So all the districts has the networking and they have a very offices in all district headquarters. And we can put the sensors in the NIC office and have the network, put it in the network. Similarly, statewide area network is a state's, NIC is a central government organization. Statewide area network is every state's organization. They have a network of their own, which connects all the seals and blocks. So basically, first thing we must do is that install sensors in blocks, tehsils, and districts, offices, and use SWAN and NIC networking. But this number is too small. It's maybe only 20-25% of the our requirement of 10 to 15 kilometers or 8 to 10 kilometers of density of sensors. Therefore, we have to look out for other options, and the very good option is the mobile towers of BSNL. Very large number of towers of BSNL are existing in Himalayas. Every place there are mobile towers, and base room of the mobile tower is an ideal place to install a sensor, because all my requirements I'll discuss will be met in the base room of the mobile tower. All my requirements above will be met at the NIC and the SWAN offices. NIC and the SWAN offices have UPS, so good power availability and the networking of and NICNET and SWAN. Base room of the mobile towers have a huge battery bank and a networking of the optical fiber cable of the BSNL is available there. Now, what type of a connectivity should we use is the next question. The requirement is, it should be least delay. The time of the transfer of the data from the sensor to the early or to the central monitoring station should be minimum. There should not be any data drop, and failure rate should be as small as possible. I cannot say that there will be zero failure rate. Wires can break or drop, things can happen. Options are hard line using optical fiber, VSAT, mobile phone technology. I'll start with the mobile phone technology. We did a lot of experiments. There are modems available on which you put a SIM card and connect your sensor to that modem and use the normal mobile phone type of a thing, dial a number and then it gets connected. And that connection can remain 24/7. But we found that there is a very, very huge amount of data drop. Very huge amount of data drop. This also we face when we talk in a mobile phone, there is a lot of time data drop. We miss the voice. The mobile phone technology, and particularly when you are working on Himalayas, it's even worse because AI is ruled out. The second is VSAT. VSAT is also, the delay is there. The data goes from sensor to the satellite, from satellite to the service provider, then again it goes to satellite, and then it will come to the CMS, the central monitoring station. So it will take about a second for the data to reach from sensor to the central monitoring station, and 1 second is substantially long time. But even worse, the satellite VSAT's problem is that in the event of an earthquake, the ground will shake, and the ground shaking will be as much as 4 to 5 centimeters. Easily, the ground can move. And the moment the ground moves, the antenna of the VSAT will lose connection with the satellite, and suddenly we will. So, satellite VSAT is good for a very small shaking, which are used for weak motion sensors. But when we talk about strong ground motion shaking, VSAT is not suitable because the antenna will lose its connection, and therefore VSAT is also ruled out. And the only option is hard line using optical fiber cable. This is the best option today, and this is what we must use in our country. And if the options are NICNET and SWAN that I was discussing, NICNET is already there. NIC is network, which is on hard line. SWAN is on hard line. And as far as BSNL is concerned, it is VPNOBB, means virtual private network on broadband. So it's basically a broadband connection, and we have a private network of all the sensors. So all the sensors have a private network. No one else other than me can enter in that network. And this type of a facility BSNL is providing. So they can, if I have 2,000 sensors, all of them 2,000 can be connected to a virtual private network, and BSNL will be able to give us the data. And this transfer of data, if VPNOBB and NICNET, it takes less than 100 milliseconds from sensor to the 1 pi. Less than 100 milliseconds it takes from sensor to the CMS. Now let's talk about central monitoring station. Now the data has come to the center, the central monitoring station, from all the sensors. This data, you need to have a software for acquiring the data. The data acquisition is required, so the software should be capable to require as much as 2,000 sensors, the data from 2,000 sensors simultaneously. This data acquisition software should be a open source software and should be user friendly. Open source means everything should be open. The software, its code, everyone should know the code. It shouldn't be a commercial software where everything is kept totally secret. It should be modular in nature. This is the most important requirement of a data acquisition software, that the software must be modular in nature. And modular means I should be able to plug in and plug out any module of data processing. Today I have a data processing subroutine or a module which I have plugged in the software. Tomorrow if I want to change it, I should be able to remove it and plug in the new one without much process hassle. So it should be modular in nature. And if we have a strong user group, that will be an additional advantage. Software known as EarthWARM is openly available. This has been developed by USGS. It is available in internet. It's a open source software. Anyone can download it and start using it. It has a very, very strong, it's a modular in nature. It has all these facilities. It is modular in nature. It has a very strong user group. And at least 2 times in a year, classes are held for teaching working on EarthWARM by USGS. So it's a pretty good software for data acquisition, free of the cost. The good point about such type of a software is that we are not bound to a commercial organization and then stuck with their thinking and their technology. We can have our own system, we can have our own software, we can have our own modules and change it. Now, once we have acquired the data, the first thing which the CMS is required to do is detect the earthquake. Today, data is continuously coming. The moment an earthquake comes, I need to have an algorithm which should be able to pick up an earthquake. I'm not going to discuss this algorithm, but it's a very well-known algorithm known as modified Allen's method. It uses STA-LTA ratio. STA stands for short-term average. LTA stands for long-term average. So it takes STA and LTA ratio and detects an earthquake has come. This type of a modules, this type of a onset algorithms are very often or very frequently are used in all seismological data which is coming in real time, and where an earthquake, etc., the magnitude of an earthquake and the location of the earthquake is found, as is done in the National Center for Seismology in India. So there also they use similar PPIC algorithms. So first thing it does is it picks the starting of the earthquake. The second is the hypocenter location. Hypocenter location is important because of when we estimate the magnitude, we need to know the location of an earthquake. For location of an earthquake, we need at least four picks. Four stations must be able to. Our data acquisition system has picked four earthquakes. Earthquakes from four stations. So what we have is now delta Tij, that means the difference in the arrival time between the two stations. So in case there are four picks, then we will have six delta Tij. 1-2, 1-3, 1-4, 2-3, 2-4, and 3-4. So we'll have four delta Ts. We use a grid search method. In the grid search method, the important requirement is we need to know the velocity profile of the region. We need to know what is the P wave velocity profile of that region and use that P wave velocity to find out delta T's of the. So assume one point that this is an epicenter point and find out delta T's. Obviously, that point is not the correct point. You will get a residue, an error, and then keep doing it. Search the whole grid after every, say, 5 kilometers between 10 to 500 kilometer depth. There may be around 2,000 such searches we may have to do. And the search which will have the least error is a point of epicentral location. The location with minimum residues to grid search considered as the epicenter. In the present day, the computer can do this process, say about 4,000 to 5,000 grid searches in less than microseconds. So it doesn't take time to do all this calculation in the present day computational facility. So hypocenter can be found. Then the next part is the magnitude estimation. I'll discuss this magnitude estimation in substantial detail in my next few slides. Then we take a decision to issue or not to issue warning. Real-time estimation of time left for, this is a product as I was telling you, I'll also show you this product. And creation of ISOP, this also I'll show it to you. This is a velocity profile that we are using for Uttarakhand region. Now my most important part of my requirement is the magnitude estimation, because it is a magnitude estimation which will decide whether to issue the warning or not to issue the warning. Now this is the recording that we are doing, the acceleration. This is an acceleration, and this is the recording that we are doing, an acceleration time history. The moment this recording is done, simultaneously the processing will be done and we'll integrate this and get the velocity. Integration process is, some processing is required. You need to filter it, high pass filter it with 0.075 hertz, and all those things are done. But what is important is that from acceleration, simultaneously the velocity is found, and simultaneously it's integrated again, and the displacement is found. This is done in real time. Acceleration is not coming in real time. So the velocity is being immediately being calculated in real time, and the displacements are also immediately being calculated in real time. Now the research in the real-time seismology has said that if it's a big earthquake, then the initial displacement within the first few seconds will be large. And we call this, so we generally take a window of 3 seconds. So this is the starting of an earthquake. This is the starting of an earthquake. This is a 3-second window. And in this 3-second window, we find out the displacement. And the peak displacement of this 3-second window we call as PD. And the real-time seismology says that this PD is related with magnitude of an earthquake along with the epicentral distance, the hypocentral distance, sorry. So magnitude is a function of PD and hypocentral distance. So this is a magnitude attribute to find, to estimate the size of an earthquake. Another attribute is the frequency attribute or the time period attribute. It has also been found by the research that in case the earthquake is of the larger size, the predominant period or the characteristics period of the velocity signal is going to be higher. If it's a small earthquake, this characteristic period or the predominant period will be small. And in case it's a big earthquake, it will be larger. So the magnitude is related with this frequency content, initial frequency content or initial time period of the frequency. Time period is inverse of the frequency of the first 3 seconds of the P wave. So these are the two very, very important attributes to estimate the size of an earthquake within the first few seconds of an earthquake. Other attributes have also been found, research are being going on, which are energy attributes. Obviously, it is expected that when the earthquake will start or when the process of earthquake will start, initially for a bigger earthquake, the energy release will be more. For a smaller earthquake, energy releases will be smaller. So there are basically three classes of attributes: the amplitude attributes, the frequency attribute, and the energy attribute. So I'll discuss very quickly about these attributes. So in this case, PD is the magnitude which is calculated from peak displacement. It will have look like A, some constant, plus B, log of PD, plus C, log of R. R is the hypocentral distance. Remember, we have found the location of an earthquake earlier, and therefore I know the hypocentral distance of the sensor and the location. So we can find the MPD. Similarly, characteristic period tau C, which I showed to you in the earlier figure, is found by this formula. This is U dot is the velocity, U is the displacement square. So that means, see, if my data is coming at 100 samples per second, then I have 300 samples of velocity, square those samples, multiply it with the dt, which is 0.01. So you have 0 to t0, this t0 is 3 seconds. t0 is a fixed time window. So basically, this means 300 samples I square and add of the velocity. This 300 samples of the displacement, I square and add and divide the two. 2 pi divided by this is what is the characteristic time period. All these things, since I will be giving you the PDF file of this presentation, for those students who want to work in it, I have given the detailed references also along with this slide. Similarly, there is another period which you call as a tau P, which is called as a predominant period, and it is calculated by this formula. I'm not going to discuss this formula again. It's pretty simple. It's between the velocity and the acceleration, and you can find the value of tau P. Again, we are using a 3-second window only. So we are trying to find out using a 3-second window, the data set, data which is coming in the 3-second window, velocity, acceleration, velocity and displacement. We are doing some formulation and trying to find the predominant period. It's not very difficult. Those of you who are interested to work in it, read it. It will be pretty simple to understand. Now these are the energy attributes with which people are working. This is CAV, this is BCAV. I'm not going to detail on this. And then window bracketed CAV, and then log average period. This is again period. These are all attributes on which a lot of research is going on present. Everywhere they are trying to relate these attributes with the size of the earthquake. And all these attributes are for first few seconds of the record, 3 or 4, 2 seconds of the P wave. And another attribute is RSSCV. So these are some of the attributes. And then now I'll talk about the estimation, the regression models, which people have found out for these attributes. Like Wu and Zhao, they have found this relationship using 25 earthquake records from Southern California. MPD equals to 4.748121 plus 1.371 log PD plus 1.883 log R. R is the hypothetical distance. Similarly, HASIO have used 186 Taiwan record and they have come up with this empirical relation. And then Wu and Zhao in 2006, they have used 46 earthquake records and they have come up with this regression model. Similarly, for the characteristic period that you must have seen, that in PD, R is being used. So MPD is a function of PD and R. But in case of a tau C, is not a function. Tau C is only magnitude is a function of tau C. It's a period. So period really doesn't matter. In case it's coming from 20 kilometers, data is coming from 40 kilometers. There's not like to change on the period. Amplitude surely changes. Now, similarly, Wu has used 46 records, come up with this. Alec et al. Have used 12 earthquake records from Istanbul. They have come up with this. And Zolo has used 296 earthquake records and has come up with a similar attenuation model. Similar empirical relationships have been used for tau P max. Now the question comes, which regression model we should use? PD of first three. So what we do is that we have also in India, we have a strong motion data record. We have 73 years of strong motion records from 27 earthquake window. And we tested three earthquake models. Wu et al., SU and Cube, which we discussed earlier. Wu et al. Provided results with least error, and we recommended to be used for earthquake. Another very big advantage of Wu et al. Is that it underestimates less than 5.5 earthquake and overestimates M greater than 5.5 earthquake. See, remember that we are talking about an estimation of the magnitude. We are not talking about determination of the magnitude. We want earthquakes to be estimated for the purpose of issue of the warning. And we want the warning to be issued in case the magnitude of an earthquake is greater than 6. So in case a regression model is underestimating less than 5.5 and overestimating greater than 5.5, if a 5.8 earthquake or a 6.1 earthquake is estimated at 6.8, really doesn't matter because I have to issue the warning only. So this is a very big advantage of Wu et al. So we chose to use Wu et al. 2006 in early warning system. This is some of the Wu et al.'s, how Wu et al. Behaved in the Indian data set. Now when we talk about the decision making, we have now magnitude estimates from 4 stations. everywhere, all the stations will give a different value of magnitude. So which is the correct estimated, which will be the estimated magnitude based on which the warning or no warning should be decided. So this is how we go about. First of all, only those magnitudes are used which are within one standard deviation. Now we take, first is that the one of the method is we take the average of all the magnitudes. Say we have calculated four magnitudes from four stations. So we take average and say that, well, this is the magnitude, and now we should, if it's more than six, average magnitude is more than six, issue the warning. And if average magnitude is less than six, don't issue the warning. Another is that we give some sort of a more importance to a station which we think are more accurate, and give a little less importance to those stations which we think are less accurate. The more accurate are those stations where the residual time of calculation of R, when we calculated R, remember, we had the residual time. So where the residual time of the calculation of the R are small, we give it more weightage. And where the residual time is small, we give those stations as the less weightage. So this is what the weighting factor is calculated. And average magnitude is that found is, this equals to this. So this will be, with this formula, those stations which are giving more accurate, are considered to be more accurate, will be giving higher weightage. And those stations, out of the four, those stations which have found to be lower weightage will be giving the lower accuracy, will be given the lower weightage. And if M is 6, now when we calculated the M, and if M is less than 6, then generate a file in the folder, no warning. What happens is, earthquake has come, 4-5 stations have picked up the data, we have calculated the M and found that M is less than 6. Then, if that happens, the folder is created, which is named as no warning, and all pertinent information about the earthquake, everything is about the earthquake is written in that file. And if M is greater than or equal to 6, then generate a similar file in the folder named warning, and simultaneously issue warning. And in this warning also, all pertinent information is written and the warning is issued. Now, how do I evaluate that the warnings which are being given is, I'll go a little quickly now. How do I evaluate that the warning given are correct or not correct? So we have to use a template. This is a line which tells that the if my estimated magnitude and the magnitude are same, then my point must lie here. And say an earthquake comes and I estimate a magnitude which is equals to 7.2, but actually it was 6.8. So the point will come here. In the second earthquake, I estimate it to be 7.78, but the earthquake is 7.2. The point will come here. Similarly, I do the plotting like this and do the plotting like this. What is, I draw a vertical line at this here and a horizontal line at 6 magnitude here. This side is estimated magnitude. This side is the actual magnitude of an earthquake. So we have a rectangle. So in case my data, the point lies in this quadrangle, I'll call it a correct NR. That means the estimated magnitude is greater than 6 and the magnitude is also greater than 6. It's a correct alarm. It really doesn't matter whether the point is lying on this 45 degree line. It may be away, substantially away, but doesn't matter because alarm, the warning is giving is correct. Similarly, you have a correct all clear here and false alarm and the missed alarm. In case magnitude is greater than 6, my estimated magnitude is less than 6, I'll miss the alarm. I call this as a win-win zone between earthquake magnitude 5.5 and 6. Okay, let's assume that an earthquake comes. People say a warning is issued. People run and take shelter. Everyone is happy that warning has been issued, shaking took place, and everyone praises the state early warning system. But when the announcement comes, we find that it's a 5.8 magnitude earthquake. It's not a 6 magnitude earthquake. Will you call it a false alarm? I think no, because the magnitude may be 5.8. Academically, the warning may be wrong. But for all practical purpose, it's a correct warning. Now take another scenario where earthquake comes, shaking takes place, no warning is issued. People say, oh, what the earthquake early warning system is doing, it's doing nothing. But when the announcement comes, it says that it's a 5.8 magnitude earthquake. So we say that if the warning is required to be issued at greater than 6, it's a 5.8, therefore warning has not been issued. So what I say is that between 5.5 and 6, whether I issue the warning or I don't issue the warning, it's a win-win zone. Chip me merry, put me merry. Head I win, tails also I win. That means if I issue the warning or if I don't issue the warning in this zone, it's okay with me. So my correct alarm zone goes like this and my false alarm goes. So what we did was we took the regression model that we are talking about. We took 21 earthquakes of the Japanese and did this exercise. And you see, we found that these three earthquakes, 1, 2, and 3, actually, academically, they are false alarm, but they are between 5.5 and 6. So I have put them in the correct alarm. Similarly, these two are also between 5.5 and 6. They are academically correct alarm. So all those earthquakes which are lying in this zone are I'm treating it as a correct alarm. So if you see that all 21 earthquakes tested for who at all for a Japanese data set falls in the correct alarm. So none of them in the false alarm. Now I'll talk about the IIT Roorkee project, which is at present going on in IIT Roorkee. Now this project was given by Government of India to us in the year 2015. It was a pilot project which was there to show that to the country that an earthquake early warning system is a feasible thing and it is possible to work on an earthquake early warning system. So in the first phase of the project, we installed about 86 sensors. The sensors that you are seeing in the pink color have been installed in the BSNL network, and the sensors that you are seeing with the green color are SWAN and NIC network. In the second phase, we installed sensors in the Kumayu region. Sensors which you are seeing in the blue color are SWAN network, and yellow color are the BSNL network. So all these sensors are right now sending data in real time to Roorkee, and the processing station is at Roorkee. So the data comes to, we are using Earthworm as I was telling you, and the moment the data comes, it's archived. We are archiving the whole data for about 3-4 months and then remove in case there are no warning. And then monitor wavering. First thing that we do is that we monitor for the event detection. And then in case the event is detected, no, we keep monitoring it. That will be doing most of the time. And if event is detected, we call it a pick event. We again monitor the pick event till we have 4 or more picks found. No, we again do that. Unless 4 picks are found, then we go ahead and estimate the value of PD. Before that, we estimate the value of the hypocenter location also, because for estimating PD, I need the hypocenter location. In case MPD is greater than picks, see, we keep doing it 5, 6, 7, 8, so many picks are concerned. They came every time, we'll estimate PD. And then in case PD greater than 6, in case it's greater than 6, issue the warning. This is estimated lead time, 20 seconds. In case an earthquake occurs in Chamoli, Dehradun will get 20 seconds lead time, Hardwar will get 22 seconds, Roorkee will get 31 seconds. Lead time is the time before the SAs arrive. Muzaffarnagar 44 seconds, Meerut 57 seconds, and Delhi 76 seconds. As of now, hospitals and few departments of IIT Roorkee are to internet, are connected, sirens have been fitted, and the district headquarters of Uttarakhand and some offices building in Dehradun and Haldwani are also using SWAN for sirens. So that means, in case any events are detected, sirens will blow in the hospitals of IIT Roorkee and some district headquarters of Uttarakhand. A mobile app has been developed, which is given to the affected users. Sirens are connected. So important thing about the dissemination is warning must be encrypted to protect from hacking. Now, this issue is a very, very important issue. We have worked pretty hard in ensuring that the messages are properly encrypted and hacking is not held. And that is why at the siren end also, we are required to have a small computer, a single board Raspberry Pi computer, which keeps checking the encrypted message. And the warning message is kept small. Authenticity of each message is checked at siren, and siren is blown on authentic message only. Specific sound of siren to differentiate from other sounds. That is also very important. Status of sirens are checked periodically, and automated generated email are given on failure. See, earthquakes, I don't know when an earthquake will come, when the sirens will be blown, but the health of the siren must be checked periodically. And the moment if a siren goes bad, an email comes to the CMS that this siren is not working, so action is taken. Now, app, I'll go very fast because it's one of my students. I do not know much about the Android system. So this is the way he has developed the software on mobile app. Now, this one from where I'll start is on receiving a warning message. App is programmed to produce a specific sound to alert users. App also gives real-time graphics of location of moving P and S wave and time left for arrival of S wave at location of mobile phone. That means mobile phone, in the event of a warning, will have a graphic which will show the moving position of the P and S wave and below a counter where going down the number which will keep telling how much time is left for S-Wave to arrive at the location of the mobile phone. App also contains information about the steps needed to be followed on occurrence of an earthquake. App also contains information about how to make and find safe places in your house. Now, as far as the TV is concerned, I'll show you, we have not yet gone to television, but this is how things are working in Japan. Sorry, it's unnecessarily delaying the time. So I will quit this. But what happens is that in television in Japan and other countries, a television screen suddenly a message appears that an earthquake is coming, take action. So whatever is going on the television, a message will appear. And we have just still not done it. But this is not very difficult to do in case the government decides. This is what I was telling you, the arrival of P and S waves. So in the mobile phones, you will see that this is S wave, this is P wave, these are traveling. This is my target place where the mobile phone is held. And here is the counter which will tell how much time is left for S wave to reach to this place. So this counter will keep reducing the number. Then when this will come here, it will become. When an earthquake finishes, a shake map is prepared. That means we know from several hundred sensors what was the PG at several positions. Immediately after the end of an earthquake, softwares have been developed which will produce a ISO acceleration or ISO PG map of the whole region. And this map is going to be a very, very important product for disaster management authorities. So this map will be generated within a few seconds of end of an earthquake. So this is also very, very important product of an earthquake early warning system. This type of a trend trading modules have been developed, what we should do and what we should not do. Now I'll talk about the most important and why earthquake element system is relevant for India. We all know that Himalayas is a place where the big earthquakes are occurring. We know big earthquake has come here, big earthquakes come here, here. It is the central Himalayas where the large earthquakes have not come. Several seismologists have told that earthquake is pending here and it can strike at any instant of time. So we have a possibility of a large size earthquake in central Himalayas. It can affect several cities including Delhi. We have a very, very large population density. So this is Himalayas. Here the Tarai region starts. And the moment we come to the Tarai region, the population density is very high. Also, this Tarai region, the entire Tarai region is sitting on a soft soil. And we all know, we have heard earlier lectures also in this webinar series that the soft soil, the amplification is substantially high. The ground motion amplitude, in fact, in some of the areas here, in case an earthquake strikes Himalayas, in some of the areas in the soft soil, in the Tarai, the intensity of the shaking may be as high as in the epicentral area because of the amplification of the soil, local soil conditions. So a lead time of 25 to 80 seconds may be available at these places. EW is most relevant for earthquake. So this is the, again, I am showing you the same map. Here I am showing that this is the area which we have instrumented and this is the area which will get benefited. And this area is very less populated and this is a densely populated area. And this entire area, unfortunately, is sitting on very, very soft soil where the ground motion will be amplified several folds. And I'll show you the position of the houses. See, unfortunately, in the entire plains, the number of houses which have earthquake resistant feature is absolutely negligible. This is an atlas from BMTPC. High risk houses are those houses which are dilapidated conditions, which are likely to collapse. Moderate risk houses are those are pakka houses, but do not have an earthquake resistant features. And low risk houses are those houses which I have not tabulated here, the 100 minus this number. The low risk houses are those houses which are earthquake resistant. So you can see that 96% houses in Delhi are not earthquake resistant. Only 4% houses are earthquake resistant. Similarly, if you look at what is happening in different districts of the Western UP, which are likely to have a very strong ground shaking in the case of an earthquake in Uttarakhand, you will find that more than a crore house does not have earthquake resistant feature. I have seen in the shake table testing for the last 25 years how brick houses with pakka, with a RCC slab, with no earthquake resistant feature, collapse like a pack of cards in the event of an earthquake. So these houses are tremendous amount of risk for having large number of casualty in case of a magnitude 7 plus earthquake. Having epicenter in Uttarakhand, all these houses are sitting on a soft soil. If you look at the population density, the instrumented area has a population density of, I have right now, this is the data for Garhwal region only. But the Garhwal region, the instrumented data has a population density of the 17 lakh. But the people which will get hit by an earthquake, which will get the benefit of earthquake early warning system, the population density is 4 crore. And it is these people, 4 crore people will get the benefit. What I am trying to say is that the benefit to cost ratio is very, very high in India. So this type of a benefit to cost ratio, you will not find anywhere in the world what you are seeing it in India. I have only one line conclusion. I don't want to mince words. I don't want to dilute the conclusion by writing so many conclusions. And my only conclusion is, a successful EW system for earthquake greater than M greater than 7 in central Himalayas can save millions of lives. This is my one line conclusion. I will not end my presentation right now because I know there are several frequently asked questions which I like to answer at this stage only. What are the chances of false warnings, sort of people ask? As far as false warnings are concerned, I am not really worried. As I was telling you, between 5.5 to 6, if a warning goes, it's okay with me. It may be academically wrong, but for all practical purposes, it's okay. And I find no reason why an earthquake less than 5.5 should be able to say that it's a 6 magnitude earthquake, because the regression models are under predicting less than 5.5 earthquake. The second real worry of a false warning is through the hacking, and we have ensured that hacking cannot take place because the warning messages are given through dynamically encrypted. So the chances of a false warning are minimum, very little, and I don't really too much worry on the false warning side. But yes, all those who are working on earthquake early warning system, this is the biggest fear always remains in our mind. In case an earthquake comes which is greater than 6, and if I don't issue the warning, the entire confidence of the people and the government will be away, will be suddenly washed away in a moment. And that is why, that's what is the biggest fear. But again, we hope that the regression model is generally over predicting between 5.5 and 7. Therefore, I hope that we will not miss warning, because if a 5.5 or 5.6 earthquake says it's 6.2 earthquake, I am okay with me. Warnings are issued. 6.2 earthquakes will say 6.7, 6.7, 6.3 earthquake will say 8. And I want to tell you that this point source algorithm, they literally saturate at 7. So even if there is an 8 magnitude earthquake or a 9 magnitude earthquake, this point source algorithm will tell me over 7.1, 7.2 or 7.3. Estimated. So beyond 7, it only says 7. So, but I'll not miss the warning, obviously. Another question which are asked is 30 seconds enough to save life? Now, we must remember that this 30 seconds is the lead time before arrival of S wave. We will have another tens of seconds available for build-up of vibration and sequential collapse. Building doesn't collapse like this. It vibrates, vibration builds up, sequential collapse for the first one. One part of the building will collapse, the walls will collapse, and then it takes several tens of seconds. So effectively, we have more than a minute for saving life. Those who are living in the ground floor and the first floor, this is more than enough time. You have 30 seconds to take off and then do a lot of things. You know that an earthquake is going to come. Earthquake has still not come. After 30 seconds, the earthquake has come. S waves have come. Then the build-up will take place. So there is enough time for people who are living in the ground floor and the first floors to save life. However, those living in the higher floors, obviously, or group living sitting in a classroom or in a hall, they have no other choice but to perform drop, cover, and hold operations as recommended by the disaster management authority. Here also, I'd like to tell you that more than 90% houses are single-story and two-storied houses. All the villages which lie between Uttarakhand and Delhi, they all have single-story and ground floor and single-story houses or two-story houses, first ground floor and the first floor, and all those villages will get the benefit of earthquake early warning system. Very large amount of life can be saved in the village. Up to what distance the warning must be issued? This is also a very important question which people ask. GMPs cannot give you this answer. If you say that, use GMP, because GMPs, we all know, are not accurate. And also, what magnitude we are finding is also not accurate. It should be decided, which will be based on the expected size of an earthquake and distance at which it can. So, if we decide that From Himalayas, the maximum earthquake will be of 9 magnitude, and therefore up to 500 kilometers it can hit. So my opinion is that whenever there is an earthquake of more than 6, issue warning every place up to 500 kilometers more. Well, those who are sitting at 500 kilometers, not facing an earthquake, not getting the vibrations caused by an earthquake, I don't think they will feel sorry for ducking or taking, running out, because an earthquake did come. They will thank the God that it didn't come to their place, but earthquake did come and they took the action, and it's okay in case they did it. This is another very important question which asks, can intensity be estimated at target cities in real time? Well, let me tell you that the primary requirement of EW system is to save life. And when you are running to save life, you are not interested in knowing what's going to be the PGA or the place. You are also not interested in knowing what is going to be the ground intensity. No one will be interested in that. So, but, and also in India as of now, intensity in real time cannot be estimated. We cannot use GMPs because M is not accurate, and accuracies of GMPs are also questionable. No GMP will give you less than 200% error. It's been done in Japan and USA using wave field approach cross plumb, but wave field approach requires just 2 minutes. Wave field approach requires instrumentation around target cities, and it requires site amplification factors of the recording sites also. I have right now the lack of time. I don't intend to discuss the wave field approach more, but we please meet that if you want intensities to be known at the target cities, these two requirements must be fulfilled. That you need the instrumentation not only around the epicentral area, but you need instrumentation around the target cities also. You need site amplification factors of all the places where the waves are traveling. And these two things right now our country doesn't have. So we need to have these two things before we are able to estimate intensities correctly at the target city. Well, I'm at the last slide. And this last slide is the driving force for me for working on this earthquake early warning system. My driving force is an earthquake may demolish a village completely. Yes, it can. A 7-8 magnitude earthquake comes, it will demolish a village completely. But an earthquake early warning system will save all lives. I'm assuming all lives. Most of the lives surely can be saved. Strength, determination, and strong willpower of mankind will develop a new village. And a new village have sewage lines, drainage, underground power, OFC cables, underground power cables, OFC cables, other amenities, and earthquake resistant houses. Earthquake, which is considered as curse, then will become a blessings to that village. This is true. Jaan hai to jahan hai. Hamari jaan bachegi to hum sab kuch kar sakte hain. Thank you. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Professor Ashok Kumar, for delivering such an informative as well as educational lecture on very important topic of earthquake early warning, which is in fact can save a lot of lives, as you mentioned. I have the pleasure of working with Professor Ashok Kumar soon after I joined Department of Earthquake Engineering in 2010, particularly on earthquake early warning project. He is a very good teacher. I learned many things about sensors, earthquake recording systems from him. I'm sure you all learned many aspects of earthquake early warning, and it's very comprehensive. And in fact, he has also included frequently asked question and answers. However, there are some questions which may need little more information or explanation from Professor Ashok Kumar. So those questions which are pertaining to this lecture I will post to you, sir.
Yes, please. Okay.
Yeah. Before I ask you the questions, I request all our participants to kindly mark their attendance. Only those who mark their attendance, they will get the feedbacks forms as well as certificates and the PDF of the lecture. So coming to the questions, there are several questions. I'm taking some important and relevant ones. There are a few questions related to the experience of success of early warning in India. The question was, is there any case study of earthquake early warning system in India where we had saved life and property from loss?
Well, the answer is fortunately or unfortunately, this early didn't have a magnitude 6 or greater earthquake in the Uttarakhand region where we have installed our sensor. But yes, we have recorded large number of earthquakes on this earthquake early warning system, but all those earthquakes were less than magnitude 6 and therefore no warning was issued. But triggers, etc., the no warning, as I was telling you, that no warning folder was created, everything was generated. So the system worked perfectly well for those earthquakes, but warning was not issued because the earthquake was not of greater than magnitude 6.
Yes, sir. There is another question related to the accuracy of the system. Somebody asked how accurate the system developed. And is this, some other one asked how this system can be implemented in other parts of the country. Particularly, his question was related to the Tamil Nadu.
Well, as far as accuracy is concerned, as I was telling you, that accuracy means remaining in the top right quadrangle of the template that I had shown it to you. That means the estimated magnitude and the actual magnitude. If the estimated magnitude, the actual magnitude is greater than 6, the estimated magnitude should also be greater than 6. If the actual magnitude is 6.1 and if I estimate it to be 6.7, it really doesn't matter because it's only the warning is required to be issued. And the warning is issued if 6 is greater than. So, in first few seconds of an earthquake record, don't expect that the magnitude which will be estimated is going to be the correct magnitude. But it should give you, but we should be able to estimate the magnitude correctly to, for the sake of issuing of the warning. So this is what I'll say, that there are so many cases that we have seen that every, if we use a regression model, almost 95% to 99% of the earthquake will fall in the green zones. Only very few cases of missed warning and the pulse warning. And this is what this template is, the only way to evaluate the performance of earthquake early warning system. We don't need necessarily look at the 45 degrees line and see how close the how close my points are around the 45 degrees line.
Yes, sir.
What was the second question?
There is another related question to this. Somebody asked why this win-win zone is between 5.5 and 6. Why can't it be lower than that?
See, in case the earthquake is less than 5.5, the shaking will be too small and people may not feel it. And if the warning is issued, people will say, "Why earthquake? There was no earthquake and still the warning is issued." So in case from 5.5 onwards, see, say it's a 5.8 earthquake and there is a 6 magnitude earthquake. As far as a human being are concerned, they can't find out the difference between 5.8 and 6. Similarly, 5.7 and 6. But if it is a 5 magnitude earthquake and a 6 magnitude earthquake, there is a substantial amount of difference. The 5 magnitude earthquake, if you issue a warning, then people will say, well, the warning system is not good.
Yes, sir. In fact, your answer also answered the other question by some other participant. He asked why we can't issue the warning for the smaller earthquakes lower than 5.5 or so, which sometimes can cause more intense shaking.
See, you must have seen that we have a 40 to 50 kilometers of a blind zone. So in early warning system, you have a 40, 50 kilometers of blind zone where no warning can be issued. Time is not, because we take about 13, 14 seconds to take issue the warning where the S waves have already traveled by about 40 kilometers. So in case we issue a warning of less than 5 magnitude earthquake, which will have only the effect in the 60, 70, 80 kilometers, it doesn't serve the purpose. The purpose is served only for a large magnitude earthquake, because it is only those who are large magnitude earthquakes which can damage 100 kilometers or more distance. Okay? So 5 magnitude earthquake will not be able to. In any case, this early warning system is advantageous for a distance of more than 100 kilometers for those places which are located at more than 120 kilometers from the epicenter. And small earthquakes, there will be nothing happening at 120 kilometers.
Yes, sir. In fact, that answered the question. There is another question. Why the relationships, whatever developed by earlier researchers, they are all done on the relatively small data sets? Why not they worked on large data set to verify the relations, empirical relationships and all?
Sorry. Well, the relationships have been done on a, well, if gentleman is asking, I'll request him to do it. It's welcome. I am presenting whatever has been published. There's no answer to why. They have picked up earthquakes of magnitude greater than 5. And perhaps in that region, those are the only records available. But yes, you have a point. He has a point. And I'll be very happy if my colleague, the person who has asked this question, can attempt to do it. I'll be very happy to help him in doing it. I have the data, and if he can try and do it for a very large data set, say 5,000 or 10,000 time histories, it will be great. Yes, I agree.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. In this regard, there are a few other questions asking about the future scope of this earthquake early warning research. Can you share some ideas for our maybe students?
As far as our country is concerned, Government of India has taken up very seriously. Remember that the early warning system which IIT Roorkee is working is on a research mode, is being operated by few of research scholars, and it's being supervised by Professor Jakka and Professor Kamal. They are the one right now who are operating the system. It's not a professional and a full-fledged early warning system which is a Government of India should have. The Government of India is now very seriously thinking of having a full-fledged earthquake early warning system with thousands of sensors in Himalayas. All that I can say is that this instant of time, this is the maximum that I can tell you. It's in the pipeline, and if all goes well in next few years, I am very hopeful that such official earthquake early warning system of the Government of India for all states of Himalayas will be in picture.
Yes, sir. That is about the future implementation of earthquake early warning in India. But anything about the research?
About the?
Research, future scope for research.
Research, I think this is the hottest topic today in engineering seismology. In every journal, you will find one or two papers on real-time seismology of how nicely we can estimate, how quickly we can estimate, how accurately we can estimate the magnitude and the size of an earthquake, the intensity of the earthquake within few seconds of onset of an earthquake early warning, or onset of an earthquake. So this is a very, very hot topic, and a lot of research is going on. Remember that this is in our case, we are taking it as a point source. We are assuming earthquake to be point source. We know that earthquake is not a point source. The rupture is along the plane. So can the point source convert it into a rupture plane? Can the magnitude estimation be improved upon? without losing the time. See, the time is of paramount importance. First 3 seconds, 4 seconds. You can't wait for 20 seconds to understand the rupture. So can the rupture be predicted within the first few seconds? These are very, very hot topics on the people are working. And the Plum method, accurately estimating the intensity at the target city. See, accurate intensity estimation at the target city may not be required for saving of the life, but for infrastructure, saving of the infrastructure, this is a very important requirement. Should the metro trains be stopped? Should the power plant be stopped? Should other infrastructure facilities should be stopped? This can only be decided in case the target cities intensities can be accurately in real time estimated. And this is another very, very hot topic on which research is going on.
Sir, there is a tricky question on algorithm usage. And I don't know how far the question was valid, but the question was, let us say there is a mixing of P wave and S wave amplitudes and due to the dispersive nature of the waves.
Okay,
they are not separated. Okay. Then what algorithm can be used to identify the time delay?
All right, I'll tell you. These are the software that we are using right now. In case my sensor is so close to epicenter that I don't have a 3 seconds of P wave, before 3 seconds S waves arrive, I reject that sensor. This is right now what I am doing. I can't, because I need 3 seconds P wave for my decision making. And my sensor is so close to the epicenter that I don't even have the 3 seconds of P wave. In 2 seconds, S waves arrive. That means it's maybe 10-12 kilometers. Then my algorithm will go heavier. That sensor we reject. We don't use the data of that for decision making as of now. But tomorrow, yes, this again becomes a hot topic of research. Can 3 seconds of P wave be extracted from the mixture of P and S waves and be used? As of now, we are not doing it.
Sir, there are some questions related to the dissemination of the warning. Some people are asking how we can disseminate the warning quickly to the population such as living in Delhi, and what kind of solutions are available?
As I was telling you that dissemination can be done through sirens, if we are trying that. Disseminations can be done through mobile apps. Mobile apps are going to be the very, very strong way of issuing the dissemination. You have your mobile app, you have downloaded the software. In case an earthquake comes, your mobile phone will start sending you a sound which is entirely different sound, which is not, you'll not hear anywhere. And you will be able to easily recognize this is an earthquake. And then not only that, your mobile app will start showing you the position of your S wave and where you are and how much time you have. So mobile apps are going to be very, very important. Then TV is that I was trying to show. I couldn't show you, but TV is another. We will be trying for radio also, FM radios, that the moment an earthquake comes, warning issued, FM radio starts telling that. And then there is a thing called mobile broadcast. It is not SMS service, but it is a broadcast. A mobile broadcast means a service provider of a mobile phone can immediately broadcast a message which instantly reaches to all mobile phone holders. And that broadcast is possible and is been done here also in India, and that is a possibility which we should explore. Again, I would like to tell you, when since I have mentioned about it, this dissemination process in a Government of India setup has to be carried out by a protocol which we call as a Common Alert Protocol, which is to be handled by a separate set of people having the responsibility of the Government of India. They should be able to broadcast it. They should have a protocol, they should have a software, they should have an arrangement with the mobile operators, with the television people, with the FM people, and mobile apps. The moment a warning comes from the CMS, it is this agency which we call as Common Alert Protocol. If this is the Common Alert Protocol, it should tell immediately to everybody. This is how it is going to work here also, and this is how it works in other parts of the world also.
Okay, sir. Quickly, if you two to three more questions. One is related to the use of electronics in earthquake early warning. Question was, is it not better to rely on other natural signals other than the electronics? So,
I couldn't follow the question.
Like, question was, is it not better to rely on other natural signals other than electronics?
For example?
Rather than using electronics to detect the onset of earthquake and issue warning, can't we rely on other warning systems, natural warning systems? Like you can say the prediction models, I guess you wanted to ask.
Well, prediction, I don't know. Prediction, a lot of
work. Animals are
right now, we are not using any prediction model. We are saying that an earthquake has come in the epicenter, and we are using the modern electronics, modern communication system to tell the people living away from the epicenter that an earthquake has come and take action. This is all we are doing right now. We are only taking advantage of the communication, and we are only taking advantage of the real-time seismology, where the size of an earthquake can be estimated within the first few seconds of an earthquake. All other things, well, everything is possible. I cannot say that what he is saying is not possible, but somebody else has, it's a different field. Somebody else will have to work on it.
I think currently, is it possible with the current state of knowledge?
I don't think so. Prediction is still not possible. It's very far away. We are talking about other ways of prediction, like so many other things we are talking about. I don't know how prediction can be useful in our case.
Yes, sir. These are the normally common questions that a common man is going to have. Very often we hear that some animal has felt or warned, something like that. So I think, sir, you answered this question. And general questions, you mentioned that wireless early warning system is currently available in India, and Government of India is planning to establish other parts. Some questions.
I'm telling you that the government is thinking of putting early warning systems all over the country, in all parts of the Himalayas, not all the country, all parts of the Himalayas. Not only the central Himalaya, but other parts of the Himalayas also.
Sir, if you take the India, where do you think earthquake early warning system fits better?
In my opinion, the central Himalayas are the most crucial place where the government must think of putting an early warning system as quickly as possible, because all scientists have predicted that, I use the word predicted, all scientists have told that an early warning and a big earthquake is due from central Himalayas based on the science, very, very important scientific studies. That there is a gap area, the Himalayas have not showing any movements here, which shows that the energy is getting developed, so it can break anytime, and therefore a big earthquake is expected from central Himalaya. This is all major seismologists in India and abroad are talking about it. So, if a big earthquake, 7+ earthquake strikes central Himalayas, and if we don't issue an early warning, I suppose we'll have very huge amount of casualty. So So an early warning is system is very, very essential for Central Himalayas, which can save millions of lives in Tarai region, up to Delhi.
Thank you, sir, for patiently answering all our questions. There are several other questions asked by our participants. Because of the paucity of the time, we are unable to take up all the questions. We request our participants to pose their questions in the feedback form, which we will circulate and share with you. They can also contact you if they have any specific
questions. I'm very happy. I want a bigger people to join in this earthquake early warning. I feel sometimes very few people are taking interest. And more the number of people joining this stream, happier I'll be.
Sir, now I request Professor S.V. Dinesh to propose vote of thanks. And actually this webinar marks the end of our ISET webinar series. Professor S.V. Dinesh, please propose. Professor Dinesh, we are unable to hear you. Can you please check your mic?
No, not audible, sir.
Professor Dinesh, can you please check your mic? No, sir, we are unable to hear you. Professor S.V. Dinesh is one of our ISET webinar committee member who helped us and guided us in arranging these webinars. It seems there is some network problem or mic problem. We are unable to hear. I think Srival sir.
You please propose, sir.
I think there is serious problem. So, sir, please excuse me, Professor Dinesh. I will propose vote of thanks on your behalf and on behalf of ISET. First of all, we are very thankful to Professor Ashok Kumar for coming forward to deliver today's webinar on such a very important topic. It is very useful and enlightening lecture to all of us. Thank you, sir. We came to end of our present ISET webinar series. Of course, we are not stopping it, but we'll come up with a new ISET webinar series very soon. We are planning to hold at least one webinar in every month, and I thank all my team members, particularly Dr. Srival sir, Professor Vasant, Professor S.V. Dinesh, and Dr. Sushil Gupta for their support in conducting the webinars. Without their active support and guidance, it would not have been possible to have such a nice series of webinars. We are also thankful to Professor A.G. Sitaram, resident ISET, who is our constant motivation and driving force and who has provided continuous guidance in conducting all these webinars. Last but not least, our participants. Without their continuous encouragement, these webinars would not have been possible. We are very thankful to each and every participant for their participation, as well as contribution to PM CARES Fund. Overall, from all these webinars, we contributed about 6 lakhs rupees to PM CARES Fund. Kudos to each and every participant for their active participation and contributing for a noble cause. Once again, thanks to everyone who helped directly or indirectly in conducting of these webinars successfully. Hope to see you all in future ISET webinars. Thank you, one and all.